is well known that general relativity and quantum field theory are incompatible. But where exactly lies the problem? Yes, applying time-ordered perturbation theory to gravity leads to non-renormalizable divergences. But is this just a calculation technique which does not work, or is there a mathematical contradiction between both theories? For many years I have been searching for that mathematical contradiction, but I didn't find it. Instead, I found a new method how to solve the many-particle Schrödinger equation of quantum field theory, a new quantization method which is compatible with gravity. Let us start by recalling the various meanings of quantization. First, quantization takes us from classical mechanics to quantum mechanics, and second, quantization takes us from quantum mechanics to quantum field theory. The combination of relativistic quantum mechanics with general relativity is still possible using the spin connection. The incompatibility only consists between general relativity and quantum field theory. So the contradiction must be related to second quantization. But what exactly is second quantization? In first quantization, we substitute operators on a Hilbert space for the real-valued variables in the classical Hamiltonian. We obtain the Hamiltonian of quantum mechanics, which we can use in a Schrödinger equation. In second quantization, we substitute field operators for the wave functions in the Hamiltonian density of relativistic quantum mechanics. Then we integrate over position space and obtain the many-particle Hamiltonian of quantum field theory. This Hamiltonian consists of two parts, the free Hamiltonian and the interaction Hamiltonian. For the free Hamiltonian, we know the eigenstates, so it suggests itself to apply perturbation theory. It turns out that one flavor of perturbation theory is extremely successful, that's time-ordered perturbation theory, which I will briefly recall now. We work in the so-called interaction picture, where the interaction Hamiltonian is time-dependent. Its time evolution is governed by the free Hamiltonian. Then we let the wave function evolve under this time-dependent interaction Hamiltonian. The interaction Hamiltonian doesn't commute with itself for different times. Thus, when we want to calculate a time evolution operator from it, we cannot simply put its integral over time inside an exponential, but we need to apply a time-ordered exponential. For this purpose, we expand the exponential into a power series. Then, for each power, we use the commutator relations to arrange the ladder operators inside the interaction Hamiltonian in chronological order. That way we get a lot of contributions. To keep overview, we label them using diagrams, the celebrated Feynman diagrams. By taking the limit of infinite times for the initial and final states, we can calculate scattering amplitudes and compare them to experimental data. The results are extremely accurate, making time-ordered perturbation theory the most successful physical theory we ever had. However, when we apply time-ordered perturbation theory to gravity, we obtain non-renormalizable divergences. This is the usual meaning of the statement that gravity cannot be quantized. Now we recall that the Dirac equation for a single particle still could be combined with general relativity using the spin connection. So there must have been some point in our calculations where we lost that compatibility. What exactly happened and where? Is it just the calculation method of time-ordered perturbation theory which is incompatible with gravity, or is there an intrinsic mathematical incompatibility between general relativity and many-particle quantum theory? To find out, let's go back to the point where both theories are still compatible, that's the Dirac equation for a single particle. A very simple idea is to solve the Schrödinger equation numerically. We are in the Schrödinger picture, where we have time-independent Hamiltonians for the free time evolution and for the interaction. These operators act on the time-dependent state of the system, a many-particle wave function over spacetime. As long as we stay in this picture, we remain compatible with the spin connection and thus with general relativity. Our model system is quantum electrodynamics, the simplest case of quantum field theory. It features one sort of fermions, the electrons, together with their antiparticles, the positrons, and one sort of bosons, the photons. These particles interact via just one type of interaction, the electromagnetic interaction. Let's do some numerical calculations in this system and find out how far we can get before it becomes necessary to break compatibility with the spin connection. In the precursor of quantum electrodynamics, an electron interacting with an electromagnetic field, we have one spin or valued wave function and a four-vector valued electromagnetic field. To store this state in a computer, we choose a finite number of sampling points and we store for each of them and for each of the two fields four complex numbers or equivalently eight real numbers. In quantum electrodynamics, each basis state splits into multiple ones for each number of particles in that state. For the fermions, this number can be 1 or 0, which doubles the number of sampling points needed. For the bosons, this number can be infinite, so we must be prepared to store wave functions for at least a finite number of them. However, as we will see later, we can get along with just one wave function for the photons in quantum electrodynamics. The next problem is how to apply the Hamiltonian to this state. When we work in momentum representation, the free Hamiltonian is diagonal. This means that we can apply to the wave function as a pointwise multiplication. We even can calculate the exponential pointwise. The interaction Hamiltonian in momentum representation is a fully occupied matrix. A close look, however, reveals that it is a convolution which we can convert to a pointwise multiplication using a pair of Fourier transforms. In other words, the interaction Hamiltonian is diagonal in position representation. Again, we even can calculate its exponential pointwise in position representation. To calculate the time evolution of our state, we need the exponential of the sum of both parts of the Hamiltonian. Since they do not commute, the exponential of their sum is not the product of their exponentials. However, we can still use that as an approximation. Using the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff theorem, it is straightforward to keep the error under control and to improve this approximation. When we want to know how a field of photons in a given state acts on the fermions, we must decompose the state of the photons into eigenstates of their annihilation operators. These eigenstates are the so-called coherent states. The time evolution of coherent states is well known and easy to compute in momentum representation. In particular, a coherent state evolving in time remains a coherent state. What is the effect of the interaction on a coherent state? Another close look at the interaction Hamiltonian reveals that the coherent state remains a coherent state under the influence of the fermions. Now, when we take into account that the vacuum state is a coherent state as well, we find that every realistic system of photons which results from interaction in quantum electrodynamics can be described, even without approximation, as a field of coherent states. This is very good news because it implies that we don't need to store the photons at each position as an infinite number of Fock states, but we can get along with just one coherent state at each position. This has yet another interesting implication. When we look at the resulting many-particle Schrödinger equation of quantum electrodynamics, we find that it is equivalent to the single-particle Schrödinger equation of an electron coupled to an electromagnetic field which obeys the Maxwell equations. We are just reinterpreting the single electron wave function as the one-particle component of the fermions and the electromagnetic field as a field of coherent states. All this implies that we cannot expect any new effects besides those already present before second quantization. In particular, we cannot expect any many-particle effects such as pair annihilation and pair creation. So, although we have set up our model using many-particle field operators, it lacks some actual many-particle effects. Why is this so? To understand this, it helps to review how the many-particle effects are implemented in time-ordered perturbation theory. To cope with the negative kinetic energy of the antiparticles, we reinterpret antiparticles as particles evolving backwards in time in a mirrored universe. This is the so-called Feynman-Stückelberg interpretation. Mathematically, this means that we reinterpret the annihilation operator of an antiparticle as a creation operator for a particle with reversed momentum, and vice versa. This implies that the interaction Hamiltonian contains pairs of annihilation operators and pairs of creation operators, which account for pair annihilation and creation. In the framework of Feynman diagrams, it is clear how to apply these pairs of operators to a state. In this new framework, in the Schrödinger picture, this is not clear at all. When we spell out the time evolution operator of the interaction in the fermionic Fock basis, we find that it performs a complex rotation between the two-particle state and the vacuum state. This is good because it coincides with our intuitive understanding of pair annihilation and creation. But there is a problem. We cannot handle the vacuum state numerically. When we try to do so, it results in infinite amplitudes. Fortunately, there is an alternative approach. The idea is to apply the Feynman-Stückelberg interpretation only in momentum representation. In position representation, we apply a Dirac-C interpretation instead. What does that mean? In momentum representation, the wave function of the antiparticles is CPT reversed. Before we apply the interaction, we undo that CPT reversal. Instead, we interpret the wave function as a whole in the vacuum state in position representation. When we apply the interaction, it rotates between that whole in the vacuum state and the particle state. After the interaction, the system is in a mixed state between particle and antiparticle states. We decompose it and reapply CPT reversal to the antiparticles only. This drawing illustrates one iteration of the numerical simulation. At first, the state is stored in momentum representation and the wave function of the antiparticles is CPT reversed. The free Hamiltonian is diagonal in this representation, so we can just apply its exponential, the free time evolution operator. After that, before we consider the interaction, we undo the CPT reversal of the antiparticles. We transform the state to position representation. Here, the interaction Hamiltonian is diagonal, so we can just apply its exponential, the time evolution operator of the interaction. As a result, the former particle state now contains a small slice of antiparticles and vice versa. We transform the state back to momentum representation, where we decompose both of its parts into particles and antiparticles and reassemble them into pure states of particles and of antiparticles. We apply CPT reversal to the antiparticle state and reiterate the simulation. This animation is the result of a simulation of pair annihilation. On the left we see a many-particle wave packet of electrons. On the right we see a many-particle wave packets of positrons, both in position representation. The dark lines in the wave packets depict regions where the imaginary part of the wave function is small. This allows us to see the directions of the mean momenta, which must be perpendicular to these lines. When the wave packets collide, we see a blue glow depicting photons. The electromagnetic waves leave the center of interaction at light speed. Since the numerical Fourier transforms impose periodic boundary conditions, we must absorb them numerically before they leave the region of the simulation. After the collision, only small parts of the wave functions are left, which have been reflected or transmitted rather than annihilated. When we look at the norms of the wave functions, we see a dramatic decrease for the fermions and antifermions in combination with an increase of the norm of the photons. The decrease of the norm of the photons on the right is due to their numeric absorption at the border of the interaction area. The increase in the norm of the fermions can be attributed to pair creation by the newly created photons. The second animation depicts a simulation of pair creation. Two wave packets of photons collide. Where they overlap, the vacuum becomes unstable and we see newly created pairs of fermions and antifermions. A look at the norms of the wave functions confirms the pair creation. In the initial state, the norms of the fermions and antifermions were not exactly zero, because otherwise the system would have kept in that state, even when the vacuum state becomes unstable. At some points, the norm of the fermions goes slightly down, which can be attributed to annihilation of the newly created pairs. Again, the photons get numerically absorbed at the border of the interaction area. This answers my initial question: when we re-implement quantum field theory in the Schrödinger picture and solve its many-particle Schrödinger equation numerically, how far can we get before it becomes necessary to break compatibility with the spin connection? The answer is, we can implement the full quantum electrodynamics, including pair annihilation and creation, without breaking compatibility with the spin connection and thus with general relativity. Instead of finding out why we cannot quantize gravity, I found a new method for second quantization which does not use time-ordered perturbation theory and which is compatible with gravity. How to proceed from here? Of course, an interesting next step would be to actually combine quantum electrodynamics with gravity using the spin connection and study any possible new effects resulting from this. It would also be interesting to generalize this method from quantum electrodynamics to the full standard model of elementary particles and from general relativity to non-commutative geometry. This theory, non-commutative geometry, unifies all fundamental forces of physics by ascribing them to geometry on a generalized non-commutative spacetime. The quantization of non-commutative geometry is still an open problem, which could be solved using my new quantization method. For further details, be invited to read my publications available from my website www.peter.gerwinski.de/physics. If you have any questions or want to discuss this, be welcome to email me at theophys@peter.gerwinski.de. Thank you.